Now I shall present our guest, Sergii Mirnyi. He's a radiation recognized officer, writer, and environmentalist, also the Chernobyl Tour founder. In August 1986, Sergii Mirnyi was cited for his courage and heroism by the commander of Kyiv military area, and after the demobilization from Chernobyl, he returned to the civil lab and continued working as a physical chemist. Also, Sergii honestly and comprehensively, like maybe no one before him, studied the actual state of the Chernobyl liquidator's health and its real reasons are in his book, maybe he will tell you about this book later, which laid a foundation for a totally different view of contemporary disasters, their hazards and mitigation. So please welcome Sergii Mirnyi, and I give you a word, Pane Sergii.
Okay. Hi to everybody. I am glad to be in this respectful company of young generation of researchers. Oh, I apologize in advance. You know, today is the day of anniversary, and I am kind of, you know, overwhelmed with different messages from many countries of the world. But anyway, I am glad that we meet, all of us meet in this particular day. And what I would like to do is to share with you my experience of Chernobyl professional mitigation worker, of Chernobyl researcher, and of Chernobyl writer, because I believe this experience, this knowledge is badly needed. It badly needed, so to say, for the two sides of this story. It needed first of all for the young generation of researchers, if they want to be truly contemporary researchers and understand the most up-to-date concepts of nature, of society, of their own life, if you will. On the other hand, it is badly needed for the Chernobyl phenomenon, because until now, 35 years after the accident, the Chernobyl disaster is, I would say, badly under-researched. And as a consequence, it is badly under-mitigated, so to say. I would even say it is rather mismitigated, you know. And what I discovered in Chernobyl, and what I will tell you a bit later, is very often mitigation measures constitute a very serious, very deadly secondary and tertiary hazard of contemporary accidents. Well, and perhaps one more comment in my introductory part is about the peculiarity of this particular anniversary, because each anniversary, I mean, not each, but let's say each fifth anniversary, you know, the shift of the mass media and of the general public's attention shifts, you know. And so at the 10th anniversary, it was a total tragedy, absolute disaster, irreparable harm, and things like this. You know, 20th anniversary was kind of intermediate, but anyway, those topics also dominated, though with less intensity. And interestingly, on the 30th anniversary, it was the Chernobyl tourism, which happened to catch the eye both of the mass media and the general public. And interestingly, now, I would say the main topic of mass media interest and of the Ukrainian authorities' activities is memorialization. You know, the concept which I started to advance 20-something years ago about the necessity of about the need to adjust memorialization to the requirements of efficient mitigation of sustaining the health of the Chernobyl affected population. So just in 20 something years, those ideas started to be mainstream, and it is what is the activities of the Ukrainian state and the Ukrainian and international media is now focused most of the time. Okay, but now, and I will speak about this also briefly and in different formats, open and not so open in my presentation. So let's start my presentation. This presentation. I tried to put in a concise way my experience both of survivor and the liquidator of my researcher and of researcher and of writer. So please let's start. You know, and what you will learn from this presentation is the general pattern of contemporary disasters and. All of you know about the disaster at the Fukushima 1 nuclear power plant 5 years ago, and literally, I guess it was fifth or seventh day. Please next slide. After the accident, on request of many mass media, I initiated a press conference in the newspaper in Izvestia in Ukraine. I did a forecast what would come out from the Fukushima accident. I correctly predicted that it will be 1,000 times smaller than Chernobyl, maybe not 10,000, maybe just 1,000 times or so, but it is all the same, as you understand, when we deal with such predictions and when we deal with radiation. And also, I correctly predicted the area of the Fukushima exclusion zone around the nuclear power plant. Now we have 20-kilometer zone around the site of the accident. But unfortunately, and please next slide. Unfortunately, my prediction had the second part that as a social event, as a global information disaster, the Fukushima accident unfolded exactly according to the Chernobyl pattern. And so the main health for the majority of the people will be caused by Fukushima aftermath at large distances from the epicenter and at the places with absolutely safe radiation levels. So, and this is because many important lessons of Chernobyl still were not learned. But so let's go back to 1986, the day exactly 35 years ago, when in the morning, the workers of the nuclear power plant and the firefighters of this plant were able to see that for the first time in the history of our presentation, the explosion broke the whole body of the nuclear reactor, nuclear fuel. They were overwhelmed. Not so quick, please. They were overwhelmed, and you know, I dare say, almost everyone on our planet was overwhelmed. It was a huge shock, global shock, which we now even cannot imagine. And because of this huge, huge emotional stress, in the perception of the general public and of the researchers of different professions, it kind of blocked their normal professional instincts. I mean, the researchers, the scientists. And now it's time to go to the next slide, because of this of this huge of this pressure. Direct pressure of the event at the researchers and, you know, on everyone. And then, you know, indirect pressure through the information environment created by society. The very basic principles of scientific inquiry were ignored. And the principle number one is that after something does not mean because of something. Many events harmful for the health of the people and societies, which were after Chernobyl, they were linked to Chernobyl. And very often it is not correct causation. What I'm numbered here as number one. You know, the contemporary science started from the notion of experiment, or started simultaneously with introduction of this notion. What is experiment? It is artificially created, let's say, artificially created measurement of or study of some features of the object under research when we change only one parameter of this system, and we keep fixed or we keep under control inputs of all other parameters which can affect the dependence which we research. Unfortunately, in case of Chernobyl, it was also neglected, and human beings as biological entities, human societies were studied, kind of studied, I cannot call it a study. They were researched, and all observable effects were attributed to radiation. And many other not so, let's say, culturally prominent, psychologically prominent characteristics of the environment, which had effects on the system, they were ignored. And principle number two, this is a simple idea that correlation is no causation, because when we see that one characteristics of the object under study grows with the growth of a different characteristic trait of this system, it is not that the first is affected is caused by the second one. It can be vice versa, or it can be that the two of them depend on the third characteristics, which is invisible in this experiment. You know, unfortunately, this principle was also largely ignored, except for a few good systematic, truly scientific studies. So now, even if I stop my lecture at this point, I believe that you would have been equipped with some useful tools to assess many works on the topic of Chernobyl and even beyond. Okay, but we will go further, and please the next slide. And in order to get the insight into a general pattern of contemporary accident, we will look into a totally different matter, into earthquakes. I am to tell you that the very first version of this presentation I did in the University of Fukushima 1 year after the accident, you know, and so for the Japanese, you know, it is something which they are pretty good aware of, and so I believe that it really helped them to fit this new phenomenon of radiation accident into their mindset. So we will see, next slide please, two cases of earthquakes. The first one is Haiti earthquake magnitude 7, and the next slide please, which resulted it's interesting how sources differ, Haitian sources say that there were more than 300,000 victims, fatalities, and the non-Haitian sources say that there is something between 50 and 90,000, and it's very typical, because national authorities, they nearly always try to exaggerate the disaster in order to get as much international aid as possible. Please next slide. The very same year, there was even more powerful earthquake in Chile. In terms of the strengths of those shakes, it's geophysics, it's easily it can be easily calculated. It was 500 times more powerful than Haiti. And so, well, at this moment we can estimate that, let's say, if you have in Haiti roughly 100,000 victims. So if this earthquake was 500 times more strong, we can expect, well, not 50 millions, but let's say we can speak about millions of victims. But please, next slide. The next slide. The actual outcome of the earthquake in Chile, much more powerful one, there were only half thousand fatalities. Why? And the answer is right in this picture. Please back. Right in this picture. You have seen the buildings, or rather the remnants of buildings in Haiti. They were built in a, you know, haphazard way, with no, but unlike Haiti, in Chile, the people, the population, the authorities, the state, they were aware of seismic dangers of the environment in which they live. And so the buildings were built according to the demands of the seismic circumstances. And because of this, as you can see, you know, the building crashed, but it did not collapse. You know, it is not the earthquake as such which kills. It is the bits and the bits and pieces of the former buildings which kill the people, which harm people. And in case of Chile, only those who were unlucky enough and who were, you know, at those cracks of the buildings, they were fatalities and they were injured by this earthquake. Of course, we should take in consideration also the geography, the density of population, which is of course more favorable in case of Chile. But anyway, you know, such huge difference which constitutes thousands of times projected from the Haitian model number of fatalities and from actual, it proves that our line of thinking is quite correct. So, before proceeding further, I would like to show you to immerse you into the atmosphere of the Chernobyl disaster. How I got my first. How I got my first experience of Chernobyl. It is, you know, the only picture which survived from my being in Chernobyl, because as it was told, I was the officer of radiation surveillance, and so this is how I looked like in Chernobyl. And for me, Chernobyl, next slide, please. So this is the morning of the day, and it's a regular work which I did. So in the morning, I would drive out of the camp a column of a dozen or one and a half dozen of armored patrol reconnaissance vehicles. And we would drive, next slide, please, into the Chernobyl zone. Next, which now looks like this. It is, please skip the map. Which now looks like this. By the way, this is map which was done. Keep map the map for a while. Sorry. Okay, which was done by Chernobyl tour and by our research division. Which later constituted one of the departments of the Chernobyl University. And so now it looks like this. It is partly, it combines both official, what is called Chernobyl exclusion zone, and also those 2 years which are to the west from the site of the accident. I'm trying to show. So this is the site of the accident. This is the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. And so the contamination was brought to the west mostly. And because of this, we have those 2 years, which are parts of the zone of mandatory eviction. Okay, and so we would drive here, drive to the town of Chernobyl. I would receive amendments to the orders of the day. Then I would dispatch people to their respective routes of surveillance, and I would jump into my own vehicle, and as a commander of a crew, I would lead radiation surveillance mission, and typically they were here in the vicinity of the nuclear power plant, the most contaminated places, like now notorious Red Forest. Okay, so let's move further. And this is how our camp looked from the highway from Kiev to Chernobyl. And so this is the camp of the 25th Brigade of the chemical defense. And I was here in the Battalion of Radiation Surveillance. And please, next slide. You know, and this camp and, social hazards of Soviet state in its and its military facet, they were here not less dangerous than the dangers, the perils of radiation inside the Chernobyl zone. It's very interesting, for example, this quote from Gorbachev, then the boss of the Soviet Union, it says that aid to people is our first and foremost task. You know, and it was kind of funny to observe, you know, when, so next slide. The 25th Brigade happened to be, you know, kind of, the best, if to use the right word, the best regiment among the military troops in the Chernobyl zone. And so on a regular basis, we had visit of generals and top brass, and it was a hell of not of one day, but a hell of several days during the preparation. Next slides, please. And you know, we were trained how to march in squadrons, you know, and during those days, we can go for the next slide. During those days, you know, I would like to escape to the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, you know, to the missions. They were, you know, it's strangely enough, but they appeared to be much more pleasant place. And by the way, it is the ruin of the exploded unit 4, as I saw it literally on daily basis from the route of radiation surveillance. And this is to the left, you can see unit 3. And before the accident, they were the exact mirror twins. And this picture gives a pretty good idea of how devastating were the explosion, which literally ruined the at least upper part, the inside and upper part of the reactor building. Next slide, please. And so this is, it shows the town of Pripyat and the work of radiation surveillance, which would drive, they would measure, and at first they also put such sticks with flags. The inscription says contaminated. And it's very funny, but there is a pocket stitched to this flag, in which, in case of war, and perhaps in the first days of Chernobyl, the surveillance crew should put a note what kind of contaminant they discovered: chemical, bacteriological, radiation, and to watch and which concentrations were measured. In case of radiation, what levels of gamma radiation we measured at certain day and time. So everything should be written and put in this pocket. Very, very nice, neat book. So let's go further. And this is the administrative building of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, named after Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, as it's proudly as it proudly says here. And we can see the bust of Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. And you know, one could see literally thousands of people here in front of it, waiting, you know, for until the time of their work. The thing is that very often the work day of the liquidators consisted only of several hours. It could be even several dozen of minutes, because there was a certain limit of daily radiation, and it should not be exceeded. And because of this, lots of people were needed to in order to run this enterprise, the cleanup enterprise smoothly and efficiently. Next slide, please. And of course, you know, it's, well, I like this photo. It shows different reactions. We see only eyes, but they are so telling, and different kinds of reactions to the inevitable exposure to radiation in this zone. Next, please. Different kinds of cleanup work. This is cleanup with hands, but I am to tell you that it was done only in the places where the bulldozers and different other vehicles could not reach. Please, another. So this is the outcome of the cleanup in the town of Pripyat, when the topsoil was taken away, collected in piles, and later on those piles would be brought to some burial ground. Next, please. You know, this was the place where, you know, huge concentration of enormous construction vehicles and military vehicles was assembled. And here we can see the military vehicle called it's hard to translate Soviet military terms. This vehicle was designed to make passages in the piles of rubbish after the nuclear bombardment of the cities. So I mean, it's really huge, and as you can see, it easily brings quite a chunk of reinforced concrete. Okay, and this is the very same vehicle at the Red Forest. The Red Forest was a pine tree forest which died after the radiation contamination. And so, and because of this, it got red color. And so it is, here we can see the initial stage of its elimination. The trees were fell down, roots were taken away, and they were moved and buried. And of course, this started from the road, from the stripes adjacent to the road, not only because it was more convenient, but because it was necessary to protect people who would, thousands of people would, if not dozens of thousands of people, would pass this road to the sites of their respective works. And so to minimize the dose, the contamination started from the roads. The roads were washed, decontaminated, and also their sides, the sidewalks also were contaminated. And this after the taking off elimination of the topsoil, concrete plates were put here, and this site later on was used for the trucks which would carry concrete for the building of the sarcophagus. Next one, please. And well, this is one of the most notorious works during contamination, the contamination of the roof of the unit 3, which was adjacent. And here we can see how the sarcophagus was built, and you can see the metal structures, huge ones, which were put in the body of this reinforced concrete building. And what we see here is this wall is made from the wood, and it is moved here to the wall in order to form the space in which the concrete would be poured later. Okay, and next slide. Yeah, one important job during the mitigation was what was called dust suppression, because the dust was not a simple dust, it was radioactive dust, and because of this, special polymeric films, polymeric solution was spread from vehicles and also from helicopters over the road. And so it would fall down and solidify and keep the dust at its place, preventing the dust particles to raise into air. And important part of works in the zone of the radiation accident and chemical accident for that matter is dosimetric check-up of the vehicles and people which exit the contaminated zone. And here we can see the process of radiation dosimetric control. And the guy here measures, it is also already wet, so it measures after the decontamination. But in general, this place around the wheel, it is the most contaminated because the dirt always stuck here. And so when the vehicle is measured, it means that it's a niche around the wheels is measured. It's a contaminated place for sure. Okay, and so next, please. And here is the process of decontamination, you know, which is kind of, we call it simply washing up of the vehicles. And one should keep in mind that it's not a simple water, but a special solution, highly active solution. Next slide, please. Which is very aggressive surfactant. And because of this, the guys who do the job, they are to protect their eyes, of course, their organs of breathing, and their bodies as a whole. You know, and imagine their shift lasted for 12 hours. And imagine when it is day shift, the shift during daytime, when it's scorching hot and they need to be in such equipment. Okay, next slide. And also, you know, decontamination shows a very, very important and not apparent paradox of mitigation works, because washing of those of the contaminated vehicle produces lots of wastes, liquid wastes, which contain not only radiation, which is bad, but which also contain lots of those I dare say deadly surfactant. You know, and there were, I don't know, immense quantities of those liquid wastes, and I was not able to learn how they were disposed of. But by the way, what I am to tell, look at this picture, that, you know, the collection of the waste were done properly. Pits were dug you know, and we see the polyethylene film which prevented this liquid into going directly to the groundwaters, which is a huge problem in each case of contamination. Okay, well, I won't bother you with those levels, but what is interesting here that even within several kilometers distance, we can see difference in intensity of irradiation, which is equal to millions, to million times. We have up to 1 zero per hour at the maximum at the deactivation sites. And, you know, we have just minuscule parts of millisievert. So it's roughly 1 million, meaning that even back then, within this, well, rather limited area, there were liquidators which could receive deadly doses, and there were liquidators which were exposed to, well, quite small doses of radiation. Okay, let's move further. And because of this, very important notion is the notion of zoning, defining different zones of different degree of danger. And here you can see that those zones, the dangerous zones, they are concentrated in the core of the of this area. But you know, this this notion will be even more striking if you will see if you will put the values which refer to different colors. And we can see that from the first color to the fourth color, the intensity of radiation decreases more than 1,000 times. You know, again, it means a huge difference in the effects of the radiation from dangerous, maybe even lethal in case of long enough exposure, to, well, negligible. Please, the next one. Okay, and it is a universal pattern through which one need to look at the map of contamination, because, for example, this is contamination of Europe with the cesium, radionuclide of cesium. And one can imagine, for example, that Alps, the slopes of Alps are contaminated to a similar degree as Belarus. But the thing is that the scale at all such maps, first, it is logarithmic, meaning that it shows not 1, 2, 3, it shows 1, 10, 100, 1,000. And it means that it decays with each next color, with each next zone. And then it is not even. You know, and formally they can be painted numerically, painted in one color, and numerically it will be just fine. But in actual values, they can be, let's say, 10 times difference, because they sit into one range, but at the opposite sides of one range. And of course, I am to add that there are certain mechanism of concentration of radiation at the remote distances by geographical reasons. The slopes which are exposed in the direction of the contamination, they collect this contaminant, and then the contaminant is washed down and it's collected near the foot of this hill at the side which of the hill which was contaminated. Okay, and the next one, well, it's one the same story. You know, all the maps of contamination, they use one and the same principle. And so the general spatial regularities, which I derived from my experience, direct experience of radiation surveillance officer and from further studies, it is the higher is contamination, the quicker it decreases with distance from the source. And the higher is the contamination, the smaller area it embraces. But, you know, the bad side, not so good side of this regularity is that the lower is the contamination, the larger area it embraces. It means that nature kind of regulates itself. So, next, please. This regularity is rather universal. This is an excerpt of the relatively recent study, 11 years after the accident, which tells that half of radioactive strontium-90 located at the two most contaminated persons of the 30 kilometer zone. And 80% of this stock at 11 persons, roughly 10, one-tenth of this area, meaning that the rest of the area is much less contaminated. And so, this is the first map which we have seen of the zone of contamination was of beta contamination. This is the contamination with the strontium 90. And it shows roughly the same pattern. The only difference is that it depends on the biochemistry of particular radionuclide. What is interesting is to compare the Fukushima accident. This is the map of contamination from Fukushima, the site of the nuclear power plant of the accident is obvious where it is located. Okay, and now we will the next slide. You will see it put in the same spatial scale with Chernobyl. And it is plain obvious that Fukushima, in terms of contaminated area, is much smaller. But looking at this picture, one should keep in mind that those two colors which are located here, at the map, they are smaller than the first color which is depicted at the Chernobyl map, because in times of Chernobyl such sensitive instruments were not available. And so one need to extract those parts and this part. And so we will see that what we have is relatively small, at least 10 times smaller than Chernobyl when we speak about Fukushima. Okay, let's move further. Another different side of the story is how radiation decreases, intensity of gamma radiation decreases with time. You know, from my personal observation, it decreased from the moment of explosion to midsummer roughly tenfold. 1 year to the next year, it again tenfold. And in 20 years, it decreased roughly 1,000 times. And I am to tell you that it is exactly 1,000 times in the Red Forest, comparing to what I measured in person back in 1986. And for example, at the periphery of the Chernobyl zone, including the town of Chernobyl, the radiation dropped, let's say, 200 times, and that's it, because it reached the natural background. The thing is that the intensity of radiation actually means the speed of its decay. Because radionuclide emits radiation only in the moment when it ceases to exist, when the act of fission takes place. And so quite naturally, and you can see it also from the first two dates, that the higher is the contamination, the quicker it decreases with time. But the lower, the slower it decreases. Again, we can see this general regularity that nature regulate itself. Unfortunately, such apparently simple ideas, they were not available, as a general knowledge for professionals and for the general public. And out of this shock, out of the lack of qualitative distinguishing different levels of the radiation danger, many unhealthy and powerful social things arose, and we can. And this dread of radiation nowadays is inevitable. I hate the term radiophobia because it should indicate pathology. But I believe, next slide please, that contemporary fear of radiation is unfortunately grounded by unique complex of harmful traits of radiation. First, it is the most easily measured contaminant. A chemical accident of roughly similar scale happened, at the time of Chernobyl accident, maybe dozen, maybe several hundred of well-equipped laboratories were able to detect it. But unlike it, radiation could be easily detected. There were plenty of instruments because all countries were preparing to World War III, and so they need to keep enough dosimetric instruments in stock. Then radiation is imperceptible by organs of senses. We cannot see it, we cannot smell it, it's not important for evolution of live beings. To hear is crucial, necessity to smell, to see, to feel, but not necessity to perceive, to somehow perceive radiation, it provides some space for but still is commonly thought to be deadly. Because our ideas about effects of radiation, particularly in the time of Chernobyl, they were at the area of Hiroshima and it was it was used very intensively in anti-nuclear propaganda. At the time, anti-nuclear propaganda meant propaganda against the World War III, which of course was a good thing, to this really deadly danger with all means. But anyway, those ideas in exaggerated and distorted way were deeply embedded in the fabric. By the way, because of combination of being most easily measurable, because we cannot see it, and because people cannot perceive differently small, not important increase in irradiation, and you know, some substantial increase of irradiation. So it created unique. The mesonin, which I started to speak about, brought lots of negative effects. For example, it resulted in misdefining the groups of the survivors and affected, you know. And for example, just to give you some, an example, when I read some paper on the health effects of Chernobyl, you know, and when I see, we studied the liquidators of 1986 and 1987 S1 group. Okay, so I immediately dropped this paper to the bin, because as you have seen from previous it means qualitatively different effects on the one hand. On the other hand, being a liquidator myself, I felt how this time the social pressure on the liquidators increased. You know, paradoxically, at the initial stages, there were more freedom here because, you know, this social military system did not and could not establish itself. There were too much work to do here, you know. But gradually, you know, and social pressure increased, and so they were exposed to quite different harmful complex of circumstances, you know. So, well, you have already heard what concerns the next problem. It is gross mistakes in health studies. And based on such mistakes, it also badly affects the medical treatment of the affected people when they are treated from very often non-existing radiation effects, but they are not treated by many harmful states which were evoked by psychological trauma. You know, it also leads to hazardous policies of compensations and privileges, you know. Well, to design a good welfare system, it is always a problem, you know, and it's necessary to bring to Chernobyl most novel knowledge of and experience of designing such systems in different countries, in different cases. Yeah, and one more example, it's the policy of excessive eviction and permanent resettlement of population. And by the way, this lesson of Chernobyl was more or less properly learned by Fukushima. And in case of Fukushima, the policies of evacuation and eviction, they were much more flexible, and they were defined both on the actual existing state of radiation contamination in the settlement, and also forecast how it will decrease with time. Okay, next one. Yeah, this is a very, I would say, traumatic picture of eviction of the citizens of the town of Pripyat, 50,000 beautiful town of the workers of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Well, just, you know, for your information, it's worth comparing not only common features, but also differences between Chernobyl and Fukushima radiation accident cases. So as radiation event, Fukushima was much smaller. Then Chernobyl, unlike Fukushima, Chernobyl happened in the country which was in the steep social economic decline, and moreover, which ceased to exist in just five years. Japan is one of the most powerful economy and well-organized economies of the world. And of course, they have proper resources and management skills to handle finally, before Chernobyl, many important aspects of radiation accidents were yet unknown. And then to tell you that, fortunately, Chernobyl experience helped a lot in mitigation of Fukushima. Many Ukrainian experts were contacted or even flew to Fukushima, and there is still very intense cooperation between Ukrainian and Japanese scientists on mitigation of the of the problem, which is general for the two countries, you know. Okay, so let's move further. Okay, now about contemporary Chernobyl zone. Next slide, please. So it is how it looked back in 1986. And the next one. And it is how it looks right now. Not only the first sarcophagus was built, which lasted over 30 something years, but much more new, absolutely at the top of the possibilities of humankind construction was built here. It's a unique construction, the biggest arch construction in the world and the biggest mobile construction on land. This is what is called now new safe confinement, or simply the arch. Okay, next please. So it was how it looked in the first months after the accident, and it is how the zone checkpoint looks 31 years after the accident. It is tourists, here you can see tourists at the entry to the Chernobyl zone, which stay in line in order to get their permits and to enter the zone, accompanied by guides in tour groups, accompanied by guides. And I am to tell you that Chernobyl tourism in numerically grew extremely intensively during last years, like it increased like 1.5-2 times a year, and it reached 125,000 people only in 2019. And then, of course, nearly all tourism worldwide stopped, and Chernobyl tourism is no exception. So in 2020, like maybe 20,000 tourists visited the Chernobyl zone. In this year, we expect a bit more, but anyway, the tourism in this site is at the moment only slightly started to recover. Let's put it so. Okay, next one. So this is the growth, which shows the general pattern and the decline in. In 2014 was caused by the war, and 15 was caused by the war with Russia, which repelled the tourists from visiting Ukraine, and then Russian tourists, and there were roughly 50% of tourists from Russia, they become extinct. Okay, next, please. Okay, but the Chernobyl tourism is not, you know, a joke or some odd, funny thing. It has a very strong theoretical rationale, and I unexpectedly come to it more than 20 years ago when I was finishing my research on Chernobyl liquidators' health as a psychosocial trauma. When I realized that it is the way of was the idea, the style, the imagery of memorialization that influences the health of the liquidators. And so the negative memorialization, meaning showing Chernobyl only as tragedy, loss, death, destruction, hopeless event, you know, with no positive prospect, it is the liquidators' efforts useless. You know, in essence, well, it's surprising that you are still alive, let's put it so, you know. And then I realized that the most powerful monument to the Chernobyl event is the Chernobyl zone itself. And one can often hear now, and it was the same story 20 years ago, it was even worse, that the Chernobyl zone is a dead area which will be lost for millennia because the half decay period of certain radionuclide is millennia or so, and so on and so forth, you know. And it is not true because because nature in the zone has flourished without the pressure of a quarter million or so human beings there. And the work of the liquidators was largely efficient, you know. The sarcophagus covered the ruin, and it lasted for 30 years. Now we have a permanent structure, the arch, which should last for 100 years. The decontamination effort was quite effective, you know, quite efficient. As I said to you, it decreased the intensity of radiation more than 1,000 times at the most contaminated places, and so on and so forth. And so for me, it has become obvious that it's necessary to change the way of how the Chernobyl zone is used by people, and to change its symbolic meaning. And I suggested the project of Chernobyl National Park, which in final version I named Chernobyl Memorial Cultural and Natural National Park. And this idea was put into practice in the part which concerns nature 5 years ago by decree of the president of Ukraine. Chernobyl Biospheric Reserve, Radioecological Biospheric Reserve was created. The crucial basically issue is to ensure the safety of the visits of tourists to the Chernobyl zone. And even 20 years ago, I took a good map of radiation contamination of 10 years after the explosion. And I was amazed to learn how much decreased the radiation. And so the dose which the visitors receive in one day is equal to roughly 1 hour of air jet flight dose. In terms of internal radiation, I also all starting from correct theoretical, except I theoretically predicted that no accumulation of radionuclides will happen during visits. And it was relatively recently practically proved by several years of annual testing of Chernobyl tour guides who spent more than 100 days in the zone annually. And this examination has shown no increase in radionuclides as in their bodies as compared to an average resident of Kiev. And by the way, for that matter, I also was in this group, and even me, the liquidators, the liquidator of 1986, even I did not have excessive radionuclides in my body. Okay. So let's go further, but nevertheless, the radiation dose control during visits Chernobyl, it's a mandatory component, and often tourists have as much as three dosimeters on their bodies, one issued by the tour operator, the other issued by the zone itself, and if they visit the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, and it's possible, the plant issues one more dosimeter. So they have three, you know, and so it both grants their psychological safety, and it provides enormous educational effects of the tours. You know, my deep belief is that visit the Chernobyl zone without a dosimeter is like visiting ordinary tourist sites with your eyes covered, because we plan our tours in such a way that to show people the abnormally invisible radiation landscape and to learn the regularity of radiation contamination of the terrain, which I talked about before. Okay, let's move further. After Fukushima, just 3 months after the explosion or so, Japanese researchers and journalists started to arrive to Ukraine, and I gave lots of interviews on the Chernobyl tourism, on how to run it. We received a delegation of the authorities, which were local and state and the business authorities, which were doing mitigation. And they were keen to learn how to organize this kind of tourism, because it's not a simple activity. It is quite complicated logistically, educationally, and even ethically. And so we trained, we prepared, and very soon in Fukushima area, the Fukushima radiation tourism started. And it gave me understanding that we have not only an isolated phenomenon of Chernobyl tourism, but we have a more general phenomenon of post-radiation accident tourism. And moreover, I realized that it is a mandatory component of efficient system of the accident aftermath mitigation. And defined five main functions: economical, psychological, information and educational, symbolic, and also I don't even know how to call it in short. It forces the social system, the management system of the post-accident zone to shift from top-bottom militarized, if not totalitarian, closed system, which is very efficient at the first acute stage. But it is, in the long run, very inefficient. It turns it to an ordinary, open, civil, sustainable state, bringing tourists, which represent their kind of general public, and independent tour businesses. And it creates more open, more healthy, and eventually more productive system. It's interesting that post-radiation accident tourism embraces not only Chernobyl and Fukushima, but also tourism to the nuclear test sites in America, in Nevada, in Semipalatinsk, in Kazakhstan, and of course also to Belarusian part of the Chernobyl zone, and we communicate and teach Belarusians how to organize this tourism and how to combine it with flourishing Ukrainian Chernobyl tourism. Okay, let's move further. Okay, well, this is, one of the positive outcomes of tourism is this map, which you have already seen. This map was done by Chernobyl Tour Research Department in order to satisfy requests of tourists who wanted to have such detailed and full map. But it demanded lots of research. It was no simple task, but eventually it proved to be a success both as a business enterprise, preparation and publishing of this map, but also for the purposes of mitigation, for extinguishing of the forest fires in the Chernobyl zone. And we have presented free of charge, of course, dozens of such maps to the border guards, national border guards of Ukraine, to the border guards of the Chernobyl zone, firefighters, foresters, police, and many, of course, to the zone authority, to the Chernobyl Biosphere Reserve, so it proved to be extremely useful for practical needs. And based on our experience with the maps, we also we made next step, prepared the first ever tourist map of the zone, where we pick up a particular dramatizing healthy style of depiction of the zone, and we use the right designer for this work in order to show the Chernobyl zone as the land which is moving towards a revival, not the exclusion zone, but rather the inclusion zone. Not surprisingly, that the demands of the Chernobyl tourism, of the hundreds of thousands of Chernobyl tourists, they are actually a driving force for the next stage of the Chernobyl recovery. I hate the term elimination or liquidation of the Chernobyl negative consequences, because the mission is impossible. You cannot return the situation in the pre-accident state. But instead, I would rather use the term normalization, recovery, revival. And so the need to accommodate the increasing stream of the Chernobyl tourists, it pushes the authorities and businesses to improve their roads, to improve infrastructure chain, including hotels, cafe, and things like this, both in the zone, in the town of Chernobyl, of course, first of all, and in the adjacent area, which was badly traumatized socially and economically and psychologically by the accident. Now, and the final part of my presentation is about how it changes in art with time. And as illustration, I would like to take covers of my books. It's a correct experiment, I would say, because each time designing the cover or communicating with the publisher about the cover, I just try to fit to the state of the perception of the Chernobyl phenomenon, how the society perceives it at that time, the prospective readers. And eventually they form a very interesting sequence. So it is my first novel about Chernobyl 10 years after the accident. It is called Worse Than Radiation. So we have two words with negative connotation. And it's about my experience. It's actually day and night of officer of radiation surveillance. It's kind of trench truth style. Okay, the next was academic paper, Chernobyl liquidators, health as a psychosocial trauma. I used for it an excellent poster, The Liquidator, by a student of Kharkiv Academy of Arts and Design. The guy somehow, just caught this crazy and in many aspects comic feeling of being a Chernobyl liquidator. And also in English translation of Worse Than Radiation, I also used reverted black and white version of the same image. The next was a documentary novel Live Force. Again, it's a much bigger piece of writing, and it embraces the phenomenon in full. And the name or the title of the novel consists of two words with positive connotation. And the cover of this book also shows well. Radiation at the background and people. And the book is about communication, about new experience those guys learned in this environment. And then to tell you that, just for better understanding, that in Ukrainian and Russian language, the term life force is equivalent to English term personnel, meaning people, military people. There is vehicles and military people. And it is how life force was represented by major Russian publisher Exmo. I did not have that much freedom. I did not have it at all, to tell the truth. when they were working on the cover of the book. But anyway, and this, it was one book in the series, and all covers were kind of gloom and doom, absolutely dirty. But on my insistence, you know, I somehow persuaded them, and the, for the first time in the series of this book, they have some light over the building of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, and they also like my logo from my personal logo from my visit card. And for the first time, they put here yellowish, not quite healthy. But anyway, you know, alive being, alive plant. Okay, and next, my piece was a fiction comedy and a screenplay, a fiction novel and a screenplay called the Chernobyl Comedy. And here you can see that it's kind of a revolution in the series of their books, because the whole area of the cover is light. We have a guy and a girl, and there is love, and there are, you know, quite nice flowers, and, you know, work on mitigation goals. I mean, it's introduction, a real life and positive prospects in the topic. And finally, you know, I would show you how I am not quite happy with this cover, but anyway, you know, it's somehow drives here we can see the ruin, we can see storyteller me, and as you can I'm sure you have already realized, it is about the hell, you know, different circles of the hell, and this image also resembles cloud from the nuclear blast. Okay, concluding my presentation, I would like to quote an excellent saying I have seen in the Wall Street Journal, that knowledge is vital, but knowledge is nothing without understanding. It perfectly fits to the Chernobyl case, because there are lots of knowledge, even real pieces of knowledge. I am not speaking about myths, but because they are not put in the general picture, because of the lack of the general patterns, general understanding of this big and multifaceted phenomenon, you know, even knowledge produces results in wrongful conclusion, and then in wrongful and even harmful actions. And I do hope that this lecture helped you to somehow better realize not only Chernobyl, but hopefully other complicated phenomena of our contemporary life. This is me leading a tourist group in the Chernobyl zone. Thank you very much for your attention, and we have half an hour or so time to communicate. Your questions are welcome.
Can I ask some questions?
Please, you are more than welcome.
Thank you for the lecture. It was very interesting, and you did so big hard work. And I want to ask, are you going to write one more book about Chernobyl, or you think that it is enough?
Unfortunately, it's not enough. You know, I would like to finish writing books about Chernobyl. There are plenty of other different and challenging topics for me as a writer. But frankly, what I feel is that one more generalizing book about Chernobyl, reflecting my personal knowledge, my personal understanding of this phenomenon, phenomenon is needed, and I would like, you know, to write such book on the one hand, and on the other hand, my understanding is that pieces of art are tools of mitigation, of treatment, of psychological and cultural trauma, of healing people, you know, and so I would like to write some piece of importance in the form of fiction, novella, and or perhaps screenplay.
Okay, thank you. I wish you good luck.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the lecture. It was very nice seeing, very interesting to hear. One more question regarding your experience. Have any of the liquidators that you might know or met suffered from the post-traumatic syndrome? So what they saw there was so traumatic for themselves that they just committed suicide, or they couldn't bear the damage. It was a traumatic experience for them or not?
You know, when I started the liquidator's health, I realized, I have heard this term, you know, I thought I understood it, but I was wrong, because post-traumatic stress disorder, or a bit, to use a bit more broad term, psychological trauma, it is not the state of individual only. It is the state of society and of individual, and because it is society defines what is traumatic and what is not, you know, in direct or many indirect ways. Okay, and so I would say that perhaps. Well, if direct radiation trauma illnesses affected, I would say maybe several percent of the liquidators, and in general, and even less among the evicted and, you know, other groups of the Chernobyl affected, literally all of them got this or that psychological trauma of different degrees of severity, you know, and unfortunately nothing was done about it. You know, the idea that those people should be treated in a special way, it was inconceivable in Soviet Union, because it was expected that the people were supposed to sustain whatever hardship they have, you know. And even later, you know, despite recognized in theory, in practice, very few things, very few measures were taken to address directly to the trauma. It's a pity very much. And by the way, it is exactly, unfortunately, the same case with the veterans of the current war in the east of Ukraine. Because guys leave the front line, they are healthy, physically, well, may be injured, but well, they are alive, you know, and they start to suffer from different antisocial or self-hazardous behavior. There are suicides reported. So even now, for this new population, the activities are not efficient enough, and it's very painful for me.
Great, thank you.
We start from chat. Question from Jonathan Turnbull. Thanks so much, Sergei. I would love to hear you writing on art related to Chernobyl as well. Have you seen the recent film Brahma?
Unfortunately, I am, you know, well, I feel uncomfortable to confess. I have not seen this movie, you know, but I definitely will. But again, you know, this movie, as I know a bit of its synopsis, you know, it kind of it did not address the core of the Chernobyl phenomenon. You know, it it exploits mythological effects on a certain population. You know, so it didn't mitigate. It rather exacerbate the trauma. Again, I am judging only from synopsis and, you know, very few bits and pieces of information I have about it. But by the way, this is a good moment to say several sentences about Chernobyl HBO miniseries. You know, I was absolutely shocked by this miniseries for several reasons. You know, it's. I mean, artists, they do have artistic license, of course, but and they exploit it. But, you know, they used they did very big ethical blunder. They used the names of the people dead and alive, and they depicted them in a way which did not correspond to truth. They could change names and okay, no problem. But you know, the director, the CEO of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, Bryukhanov, was absolutely decent man, good engineer, maybe too mild a personality. And he behaved in a quite decent way after the disaster. Dyatlov the same, also the deputy chief engineer of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, and so on and so forth. You know, and so it's just wrong. And then another drawback of this documentary is that it is largely based on the novella on the novel of Svetlana Alexievich, The Chernobyl Prayer, which was written 20 years ago. 25 years ago. Anyway, yeah, 25 years, roughly 25 years ago, exactly 25 years ago. And which reflected, you know, it was 10th anniversary of Chernobyl, and the general mood was gloom and doom and things like this. And Alexievich did very professional and very courageous work, and he fixed it in her novella. But since then, the understanding of the Chernobyl phenomenon and the understanding of the consequences of the Chernobyl accident, both negative and positive, they have substantially developed and to a brighter side. But this film, you know, it is conceptually obsolete because it used the work of Svetlana Alexievich, which is already a historical, let's say, piece. And then it is obsolete aesthetically because it used the way of depiction of the Soviets, which was borrowed from Hollywood movies of 1950s. When there is, you know, one of the most acute moments of the Cold War, and you know, and it produced many caricature images in Hollywood movies, you know, and again it borrowed this, you know, and speaking a bit more concretely, for example, about the liquidators. You know, the depiction of what the liquidators did and how they lived, it's just, it's more than distortion. I feel like using the word lie, because, you know, it looks like the main job of the liquidators was to shoot dogs. And it was just a small episode from the Alexievich novella. You know, 100,000 people work there, and you have seen them in my portraits, you know. And they were working hard. They behaved quite decently. They showed substantial courage. Because if everything was like shown in the movie, who in hell contaminated tens, if not hundreds of square kilometers of land? Who built the sarcophagus? Not to say that drinking was strictly prohibited in the Chernobyl zone, and for good reasons. And there were one case simply can, it was, you know, a law around the Chernobyl zone, and it was impossible to buy any alcohol in the shops, not only in the zone, but in a huge area around the zone. So, you know, it's just, you know, fantasies. And it's a pity very much because, you know, the heroic deeds, the courage, the decency of the liquidators is until now is not reflected properly in arts. And it's very painful for me. And it is what I try to somehow compensate with my more than modest possibilities.
Thank you for your presentation and such a beautiful talk. I think it's one of the most coherent representation of the Chernobyl and events and what happened after that I've heard in my life. And I also want to thank you separately because I had a lot of friends who would come to Ukraine and the first thing they would want to see is Chernobyl zone. And I always was ambivalent about that and had mixed feelings, but you've proven that you have a very good arguments why that tourism should be developed. So my question is, what do you envision for the zone in the future? What do you want to see and what do you think will happen and how the zone could play a role for Ukraine on the world arena? Because it's not a secret that Ukraine is often perceived in association with Chernobyl.
Yeah, sure. And for about 10 years I studied and made research and lived abroad. And I perfectly know that when one says I am from Ukraine, the first association is Chernobyl. And my concept is, and I consistently advance it both in my scientific and in my literary works and in my mass media presentations, is that we Ukrainians are the nation of the Chernobyl victors. We have contained Chernobyl, and we continue to live in post-Chernobyl country and in post-Chernobyl world. And moreover, we teach other, even the most developed nations, how to deal with such traumatic event. So, and my understanding is that what we do by means of Chernobyl tourism is we kind of dissolve this tumor of the Chernobyl zone, which is switched, disconnected from the rest of the world. When one drives at the road, at the highway to the Chernobyl zone, fewer and fewer villages and people, and you feel like you reach the end of the world. And there is nothing behind it. And it's true because the road ends there. And now I'm very glad that largely because of our, decade of efforts, Chernobyl tourism is recognized as a legitimate activity in the Chernobyl zone by the authorities, and we very intensely and productively communicate with them. And what we do, what we suggest to them, it is to open additional checkpoints to the zone. Because now we have just one checkpoint, and in 2019 there could be like 1,500 people on certain Saturday in high season, and Saturday is the most visitable day of the zone, day of the week in the zone. Then we suggest new routes. routes by water, hydrofoil route from Kiev to through Dnipro River, then the reservoir, and then to the river of Pripyat and to the town of Chernobyl and perhaps even to the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. We have already opened kayak tours at the periphery of the zone, which is well, almost not contaminated, I would cautiously put it in such a way. Now we work on the bicycle tours at the Chernobyl periphery. And in what we would like to do is to make pedestrian tours in the zone for hikers. And keep in mind that in order to organize each tour, we need to ensure that the route is safe, you know, and so dosimetric control here, you know, otherwise it's, you know, an abandoned area. Then it's necessary to improve infrastructure and so on and so forth. And gradually, this, you know, this area of contaminated and unknown and potentially harmful, you know, is kind of, there are cracks, you know, and roots and so. And one more thing which we try to do is to connect Chernobyl tourism in Ukraine with tourism in the Chernobyl zone of Belarus. They have very old, 30 years old, Polesky radioecological natural reserve. They have very interesting achievements in keeping, in dealing with both wildlife and agricultural experiments, how to plant at the contaminated areas. And it's very interesting. And we would like to communicate, to connect those, to make possibility for direct transfer from the Chernobyl zone of Ukraine to Belarusian Chernobyl zone, you know, and so things like this. And just to finalize, such efforts, they kind of dissolve this tumor of the Chernobyl zone, and gradually, step by step, our efforts return the zone to its to more normal state. It's a long process, but I believe that gradually it will be used to its full capacity by people, to educate people. And by the way, you know, maybe some of you have seen this logo here, Chernobyl University. Recently, relatively recently, we combined different activities, research and academic and educational activities, and we started an open platform. A startup platform, Chernobyl University, to better shape our cooperation with the leading universities in the Western Europe and in the United States, you know, and in general to give more possibilities to young researchers to join the topic. So. And we are open to cooperation in educational and research projects.
Thanks. You actually caught my attention greatly on Chernobyl University. Regarding this topic, I wanted to ask you, will you be studying only Chernobyl case, like the frame of Chernobyl case, or you will try to learn something from that and give some coordinations to other parts of the world, how to act in case of these disasters and what to do?
You are quite right in your idea, because it was exactly what we wanted to do. The problem, by the way, even in research of Chernobyl, was that because of this bad impact of radiation perception, Chernobyl was studied as isolated phenomena, one of its kind. When I studied it, one of the efficient ways was to put it into certain different prospects. And for example, one of the most productive comparative study for my research was the American veterans of Vietnam War. because it is back then, back on this population, the very notion of post-traumatic stress disorder as a disease was conceived. It was recognized for the first time as a disease. And it's only one comparison. Then, you know, Fukushima cases, because radiation is the easiest measurable contaminant, it gives the general pattern for different ecological accidents with contamination of the area. And in general, Chernobyl is the most developed case of contemporary, not only radiation and not only ecological event, but also mass traumatic event. Because radiation is so much erosion population and mass media, that all features of contemporary accident, they are shown in this case. And so we are oriented towards comparative studies most of all. Of course, keeping in the core of our physical presence and in the core of our focus, the Chernobyl accident, simply because it is so well, so big and so qualitatively developed in all its features. You know, as I once called it, that Chernobyl among ecological accident, it is the same as the Holocaust is among mass traumatic events. You know, it's kind of something which shows the phenomenon as such, let's say. Because even before the Holocaust, there were genocides. They were not something exceptional. But you know, the Holocaust has had so particular and so penetrating features, you know, that it was a principally new phenomenon for our civilization. And Chernobyl, for that matter, also is a principally new phenomenon. Phenomenon first of its kind. Please.
One last thing about this. What do you expect from the participants? And which people you would like to recruit to this Chernobyl University?
From participants, we expect to develop some kind of idea of their research or let's say of a particular something they want to see in the Chernobyl zone. It's a bit lesser, more light version, okay? And to come to us, and we would gladly communicate, contact the person with other experts with whom we cooperate, you know? And so jointly we would create a workable, a doable, interesting and truly contemporary project, which can be realized and which can gain good academic, Nobel academic results. In terms of teaching, we would like to mass produce the existing experience when a teacher or a group of young or not so young researchers or professionals approach us and with certain specific requests. They would like to learn something about Chernobyl, to see something special, something special, and their need cannot be satisfied in our ordinary so-called acquaintance tours. You know, and so jointly we will design this tour, or we will design a course on-site, educational course. And just to give you the idea, for example, one of the top environmental sciences program in the world is the one of Wageningen University from the Netherlands. And so annually they visit Chernobyl and we run for them special educational tour, and I deliver a pre-visit lecture for them. They come with their two professors. This is one type of courses. But maybe surprisingly for you, for several years in a row, we host a course in history from World War to the Cold War from the University of New Haven in the United States. So the course would arrive to Kiev with their professor, and they have part of the course in France, in Normandy, and in Italy. Then they visit Ukraine, and we show them not only Chernobyl, but of course we show the Chernobyl nuclear power plant as a part of Soviet nuclear program, which was largely evoked by the military needs. We show to them huge military antenna in the Chernobyl zone, the former Soviet military base, which was built to trace the launches of the American intercontinental missiles during the Cold War. Then they visit the place of the biggest river assault crossing in the world, in the history of the worlds of war. This is the battle for the river Dnipro during the World War II. And there is also a museum. Around Kiev, there is a huge Kiev fortified region, and we visit this region. And so to say at last, but definitely not at least, they visit the Soviet missile position. So in this particular position, intercontinental ballistic missile with thermonuclear warhead was located, you know, and the tourists see this location of this military regiment, and they are able, just imagine it, a red button which could have erased one third of the United States. You know, and it is the officers who served at this site, and now they are guides at this unique place. You know, and frankly, I was quite happy because, of course, we collect feedback from each group with which we work, and many of American students, after seeing Normandy, you know, and Italian World War sites, they said that the most impressive was the Ukrainian, the Kiev, the Chernobyl part of their course.
Okay, that's impressive. Thank you.
Okay, so I excuse me for going into detail, but I believe you know you'd better have some feel of what we do here.
I was actually just interested if how you're gonna spread among the country and the countries the information what was Chernobyl and what we have now and how we have to deal with this. Because I know that annually, on the very same day, yesterday, there are movies about Chernobyl catastrophe are shown in Ukraine, like in some channels, TV channels. But that's all. When I was a kid, we didn't know too much about it because it was rarely spoken about this event. So I was thinking if you will be looking for people who will be not only teaching this stuff or some grown-up people, but also the kids about the event and how to act if something like this happens.
Well, I just agree with you. I mean, with your way of thinking, because it is what we try to do. You know, and to be frank, I realized it even during the first months of mitigation, when I watched it in person and participated in it, I realized how formal structure, how much formal structures, formal authorities, how they lag behind dealing with something truly new, you understand? And it was a major impediment both for mitigation of Chernobyl at its initial stage, and for its research, and also for further mitigation. And now, when we started to run our educational courses, we started to cooperate with universities. And I realized that established universities, they have a very rigid structure. And even in the best universities, it's sometimes very hard to fit something which is not standard for them into their existing practices, and it is even worse with Ukrainian universities, because they have so tragic, I would say, bureaucracy, largely inherited from the Soviet Union, and it is not fixed yet by their connection to the international system of higher education, that it's, well, not hopeless, but next to hopeless. It's very hard to organize something new, and so it is why we established our institution, which is flexible. Because we, of course, we do have some standards of quality, standards of safety. But in general, we formulate our standards just from our recent practices, and it's very interesting. It's very thrilling, And it's a good feel that you are in a live, rapidly growing. Vibrant place.
So thank you once again for all of you for joining.
Thank you and good luck. Bye.